Feeling like taking a coffee break? So do I. What about we talk again about this JEP 425, about virtual threads, brought to you by the project Loom. And I heard you, I read your comments you added to the previous JEP Café, you asked for some code, so let me show you some code. This is still about the JEP 425, the virtual threads, delivered by the project Loom. And this is probably one of the most anticipated preview features of the JDK 19. You probably know that blocking a platform thread is expensive. And this is why you try to avoid that at all costs, and why you end up writing reactive code based on callbacks. Reactive code works great, but it makes your code hard to read, hard to test. This is clearly not an ideal situation. Well, with the JDK 19 and VirtualThreads, blocking a thread becomes so cheap that you do not need to write reactive code anymore. Your good old blocking synchronous code is just fine. So, let me show you how all this is working and why you should not fear about blocking a thread anymore, as long as it is a virtual thread, of course. First thing first, how can you create a virtual thread? Super simple, in fact. Let me show you what has been added on the thread class. I have two factory methods, offVirtual and offPlatform. Let me just call this offPlatform. And from there, I can create either a started thread directly or an unstarted thread. So let me call unstarted and just print the current thread to see what it gives. And this is basically a thread. Let me call it pthread. Now, if you want to run this thread, you need to call start because this is an unstarted thread. And if you want to see a result in a console, you'd better call pthread.join, for instance, to make sure that the main thread will not die and with it the application dies before this task had a chance to run. So if I run this code with the preview features enabled, of course, you can see that this string of character is properly displayed. This is the classical string of character printed by platform threads. Now, let me just copy this code, paste it there, call this variable vthread, and replace this call to offPlatform by a call to offVirtual. And let me run this code again. And now you can see that this virtual thread has been launched with a different string of character. Let me print some more information. What I'm going to print is the class of this virtual thread, vthread.getClass. If I run this code, you can see that I have a new virtual thread class in the JDK. Let me open it. This virtual thread class is an extension of base virtual thread, which is itself a sealed class, only extended by virtual thread and bound virtual thread. This virtual thread class is final and it's not public, so you cannot interact with it directly from within your code. You can see that this virtual thread is not the first one in your application. Your JVM uses many threads for the garbage collector, for the just-in-time compiler, so this is expected. Second, you can see that this virtual thread is running on top of another thread called fork join pool 1, worker 1. You may have already heard about fork join pools. They are part of the fork join framework added to the JDK 7 in 2011. In fact, the parallel streams from the JDK 8 are working on top of this framework. A fork join pool is basically a pool of threads. You already have pools of thread in a JDK called the executors or the executor services. So why would you need another one? Well, fork join pools do not work the same as executor services. An executor service has one single waitlist to store their tasks, in which threads are going to take them. On the other hand, a fork join pool has one waitlist per thread. When a task run by a thread generates another task, this task is added to the waitlist of this thread. This is what happens when a big task forks two smaller tasks when you are running a parallel stream. To prevent the so-called thread starvation problem that happens when a thread has no more tasks in its waitlist, the fork join pool also implements another pattern called work stealing. That is, a starving thread can steal some tasks from another thread's waitlist. Now, this specific fork join pool is not the same as the one that is used to run your parallel streams, for instance, which is the common fork join pool. You can see that I'm going to fetch this common fork join pool and submit a task to it. Let me just copy this code there to print this thread. This is a task. It's a fork join task that in fact is a future. So what I can do is just call join on it, run this code. And you can see that this thread for the common fork join pool does not have the same name as the thread that is running our virtual thread. So this is not the same fork join pool. So this is how virtual threads are working. They are running on top of platform threads. Now you may be thinking that there is no performance gain here, just overhead. So what's the deal? Well, there is more about virtual threads. Let me show you something. Let me show you how this code is running. See, I am creating 10 virtual unstarted threads with this stream pattern. And the task that these threads are running is just print the current thread. Then I put them to sleep for 10 milliseconds and then print the name of the thread again. And at the end of the day, I just start these unstarted threads and call join to make sure that everything will be seen in a console. So let me run this code. And you see that something really unexpected is happening here. The same virtual thread is running first on top of the thread one of this fork join pool. And then when it comes back from sleeping, it is running on top of the thread eight. So in fact, it could jump from one platform thread to the other. If you do this on your own machine, make sure that you are launching enough virtual threads, because you will probably not observe that with only one or two threads. So what is happening here? How can a virtual thread jump from one thread to the other? What is the magic behind that? Well, there is no magic. As you can guess, at the core of this, there is an object called continuation. Let me show it to you. Let me see what is taking place in this sleep method. You can see that there is a special processing if the thread is virtual or if it's not virtual. This is the else part of this if branch that is calling a native sleep zero method. But if the current thread is in fact a virtual thread, then this method is going to be called. So let me visit it, sleep nano. And you can see that inside sleep nano, I have a call to do sleep nanos. So let me visit it. And then a call to try yield. Let me visit this try yield method. By the way, I am still in the virtual thread class. And then I have a call to yield continuation. And now what I'm really calling is continuation.yield vthread scope. This is where the magic is happening. This continuation object is at the core of it. Let me show you how this continuation object is working. A continuation works with an instance of continuation scope. So I just created one here and pass it to the creation of this continuation. And the second argument is just a runnable. So here I'm just displaying running. And if I run this code with the proper options for the JVM, you can see that calling in fact the run method on this continuation object just executes the runnable this continuation is built on, which is not really exciting. But now let me call the continuation.yield and pass this scope as an argument because this is what the continuation needs. And I'm going to display another message after this call to yield telling still running. And now if I run this code again, well, you can see that this still running message is not displayed on the console. So in fact, yielding a continuation suspends its execution. Let me print something else here and call run again on this same continuation object. Let me run this code. And now you can see something that is really unexpected. The execution of this runnable continued after the call to yield. This yield can suspend the execution of a task that can be continued if you call run again. This is new in Java. How is it working under the hood? In fact, when a continuation yields its task, the corresponding stack is moved from the platform thread it is running on to the heap memory. So now, this platform thread is free to run another virtual thread. When this task gets the signal that it can continue running, then its stack is moved back from the heap to a platform thread, but not necessarily the same. So this is the price of blocking a virtual thread. Moving the stack of this virtual thread to the main memory and back. Blocking a virtual thread is not free. Nothing is ever free, we all know that. But it is much, much cheaper than blocking a platform thread. The nice thing is all the blocking operations of the JDK have been refactored to leverage that. That includes IO operations, synchronization, and thread.sleep. How many platform threads do you need to run your virtual threads? Well, we can test that. Let me create VirtualThread and gather all the corresponding platform thread names. This code is basically launching 5 VirtualThreads, and then it extracts the pool name and the platform thread name using some fancy regular expressions. And then, at the end of the day, it just prints the different statistics, the time it takes to run this code, the number of calls I have on my CPU, the number of thread pools, and the number of platform threads. So let me run this code. For 5 threads, it uses 4 platform threads. Let me use 10, run again. 10 threads is still 4 platform threads. Let me use 100. Now it's 9 platform threads. Maybe 1,000. It is still 9 platform threads. Let me increase to 10,000, still 9 platform threads. Sounds like we have a pattern here. 100,000, still 9 platform threads. And by the way, even if these threads are not doing much, just some regular expressions and adding elements in a concurrent set, you can see that it takes only 160 milliseconds to run all these threads. So let me go up to 1 million threads. Less than 1 second and still 9 platform threads. What about we try to launch 10 million virtual threads? Have you ever tried to do that? Launching 10 million platform threads on your machine? Well, usually it's not possible, but with virtual threads, we may be able to do it. Let me do that in real time. You may be thinking that I'm cheating, that this is not real time, but it is real time. Really, launching 10 million threads with Loom on this 3-year-old laptop that is also capturing this screen to make this video takes a little less than 16 seconds. This is just amazing. This is what Loom is doing. There is one thing that can prevent a virtual thread stack to be moved to the heap memory, though. You know that in a C language, you can get an address on the stack by writing this ampersand character in front of a variable. And this is a problem here, because if you move this stack to somewhere else and try to put it back on another platform thread, there is very little chance that this address will still be valid. So if you have some C code in your VirtualThread stack, or at least an address in this stack will be pinned to your platform thread, and it may block it. If your code is not blocking, or blocking for a short amount of time, then it's okay, the performance hit will be minimal. But if this code blocks for hundreds of milliseconds, then you may want to do something about this situation. There are several places in the JDK where C code calls have already been replaced by Java code. This is the case for the method class, for instance, that has been refactored to use method handles as part of the JEP 416. Let me show you how things are working with synchronized blocks. Here I have 100 threads, virtual threads of course. I display the current name of this virtual thread to get the name of the platform thread. And then I increment this counter with a delay of 1 microsecond within a synchronized block. And I print the name of the thread again, and then do the same again twice, so that 3 times on the overall. And the end of the code is just the same as usual. I start the thread, join them, display the value of the counter, which should be 300, and then display the number of platform threads that have been used. So let me run this code. Indeed, the value of the counter is 300. The number of used platform threads is the same, 9. But what you can see is that our virtual thread could not jump from one platform thread to the other. Why? Because this synchronized stuff is in fact using an address on the stack. Loom knows that and it pins this virtual thread to one platform thread. Now, let me run the exact same code with reentrant locks instead of synchronized block. You see that now the basic synchronization element of this code is based on the use of a reentrant lock instead of a classical synchronized block. So let me run this code in the same way. And now you can see that this virtual thread may jump from one platform thread to the other, 1, 2, and 12. The synchronized block itself is not really calling any C code, but it needs addresses on the stack to work, so the problem is similar. If your synchronized code is not blocking, then it's okay. But if it is, and you experience performance issues, then you may try to use reentrant locks instead and see if it improves your situation. What happens if too many platform threads are blocked? Well, the fork join pool can detect that and will create more platform threads, at least temporarily. And of course, it comes with a performance hit. So you asked for some code, I showed you some code, and I hope you liked it. What about you tell me about that in the comments? And what about we talk about structured concurrency next time? That's the second part of Project Loom, that is using virtual threads to make asynchronous programming easier. What about you tell me in the comments if you want to see that in action next time we meet. And with this, I'm out of coffee, so that's it for today. Talk to you soon.